Yeah, it was yesterday at Joni's funeral. Part of our deal is what we're supposed to do is to come and help show that light. Amen?
Right.
That's what we do. And we do it at times when we're not even, you know,
exactly.
Okay, I'm going to try to show you my light. I don't have to try.
No.
It's there.
Exactly.
And people respond to that. They're not responding to me. They're responding to Christ.
Amen.
And if I have that mindset each and every day, guess what?
Yeah.
More and more people are going to be able to respond to
Amen.
Him because what can I do for you?
Yeah.
I can't do a thing. But Christ can do
yes.
everything. Amen?
Yes.
He is real. He's awesome. Give the Lord a hand clap. He's real good. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. I want to give God glory this morning. I want to thank him for my wife's complete 100% healing. It is on the way. It's not on the way. It's there.
Yes.
So just to walk in it, receive it, and, you know, so my testimony is just that healing is wonderful, isn't it?
Amen.
And it comes through him. Praise God. Anybody else this morning have a word you want to share, a prayer, anything? Yes.
Some fathers, you know, had opportunity to be there more in their families than others. But to those fathers that's really trying, you know, some especially, like I deal with individuals that, you know, weren't there for their kids, you know, and now they want to be there. And it's hard to redevelop that relationship. But I just want to, you know, let them know that, you know, God understands where you're at. And he understands your heart, you know, and he wants us to make an effort. You know, there's one thing about your kids, you know, one person asked me, because her dad wasn't in the picture, does my dad ever think about me? And he's in a separate country. I said, any kind of dad that loves his kids is always thinking about them. You know, you're wondering if they're healthy, getting fed my life verse was Psalm 37:25. And David, you know, he lived 7 years. He said, I was young, but now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging bread. And I stick by that.
Amen.
Because I know you stay with God. That my mom would say that. You know, you stay with God, he'll stay with you. And it's so true. And even, you know, he still seeks you out. He still loves you. And you know, and I think every day when we take time to praise our Father and just thank him, not to go to ask him for stuff. You know, sometimes we go and we ask, and I've got all these requests. But, you know, it's just like a natural father. It's nice when the kids just say thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Dad. I don't want nothing. Just come to tell you I love you and thank you. God wants that same thing.
Yeah.
To be praised and thank that, you know what, God, I'm just going to trust you today. I'm going to trust you. You have all my needs, and they're found in you. And I just want to thank God that he loves so much every day.
Amen.
Amen. Take it to the world, but I was at the Aldi's, which I hardly come to this one on this side. I usually go to the one by my house, but for some reason I came to this one. And as I was walking out of the parking lot, the Lord says, go tell this lady this. And I, you know, you're just shaking your boots, dude. I don't know that lady. She might cuss me out. You don't know what's going to happen. So, I mean, I'm just kind of shaking, literally shaking and saying, but I just kept sensing the Lord was saying, I have a word for her, you need to go share with her. So I says, Lord, I'm going to go take my cart back up there. But then she'll be gone, right? Come on, we're all human. So I'm just kind of puttering, taking it and thinking, well, should I leave my quarter here? Should I take my quarter? Because sometimes I leave it for the next person. And I'm just kind of piddling around, thinking, hurry up, lady. So she starts. Gets in her car, she starts it, and she pulls out, and she just sits there. And I'm like, lady, put the thing in drive and go. And she does it. So I go up to her window, and she rolls her window down like, dude, no big deal. I mean, I would probably say, dude, who are you? And so I spoke to her, and she looked at me, and she says, thank you, and rolled her window back up. And I thought, well, at least I didn't get cussed out. You know, and it, like I told John, it didn't mean a lot to me, the words that I said, but it could have meant to you. You know, it was just basically the Lord had heard her prayer.
That's
that she'd
right.
been praying, you know, and a couple other things that I said. And she says, thank you, and drove away. So, you know, I just pray that the Lord, that's what I've been praying, Lord, give me boldness to, you know, it's easy to pray for my clients. I know them. You know, they know me. That's not out of my comfort zone at all. But to get out of our comfort zone and to, you know, go up and don't know if they're a believer, don't know what you're going to reaction's going to be. That, you know, that's what our real hunger like, you know. You know, we can hunger for God here, but
right.
our hunger needs to be for the lost and for those that are hurting out there every day.
Needs to go. Needs to go.
You know, so
yeah,
I thank the Lord that he gave me boldness and my scaredness that I didn't get cussed out. Punched
yeah.
out.
Praise the Lord Jesus.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Yeah, when you were talking earlier about light, about the scripture that says we're to walk in the light and see in the light. And it's like we're in a bubble, you know, and the world might think that we're doing escapism, you know, just retreating in this world with what they think is not reality. But it's the other way around. They're the ones that are rejecting what is real.
That's right.
We're looking at things as they are, and we, like Brother Hamlin said so often, we look at things as they should be, you know, not the way they are. It's like believing for your wife, you know, it may not appear, but in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Friday night we was in here and just in the presence of the Lord, entering into his rest, just worshiping and loving on the Lord, just proclaiming. And he always answers. He speaks to us as we're going through the situation. And before we even got to the last song we were being led to, there was a song that was written 19, 20 years ago at a Heart of David conference that manifested in the room. Started playing it and stuff like that. Well, anyway, the unity here was so tight with the unity of the Holy Ghost and what was going on. Basically, the words of the song were, "Praise the Lord, oh my soul, praise the Lord." And this went on for 15 minutes or so, I believe. I got to the point where it couldn't be contained in this room anymore, and Mark ran to the back room and opened up the doors and just let it wash out into the road. We don't know the spiritual realm of what happened, but I know there was a flood happening. It's just like the walls were swelling and the roof and the floor were expanding, and it just could not be contained in here. And I appreciate Mark's heart being sensitive to the Holy Ghost and just letting it rip out into the highways and the byways. So we're going to praise and worship him some more, because I just can't stop. I just can't stop.
That's right.
Yes, Lord, 'cause every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, yes, every tongue confess.
Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, Jesus.
Come on now.
Can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, Jesus.
Everybody come on.
Can't stop. Praise his name,
I just
can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name.
God.
kingdom come. He is the God who saves again. And we will gladly run into the glorious sun, singing that Jesus is alive.
Happy Father's Day, Lord. Into the loving arms of our Father. Into the loving arms of our Father.
Oh, my heart aches for you. Father. We love you, Father. We love you, Father. We love you, Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Breathe on us, breathe on us, breathe on us, breathe on us, Holy Spirit in this place. Reveal your heart. We hear your heartbeat, Lord. Reveal your heart. Reveal your heart, Lord. Just tell the Lord you love him, church. Just tell me you love him. Father, we love you. Standing at a river, and there are some or one or many that are standing at the river, and the Lord is asking you to cross over that river. Lord, help our unbelief. This river is the river of belief. Lord, help us with our belief. If you have never received the gift of the Holy Spirit, just ask for it now, because he's releasing it in this room. In Joel 2:28 and in Acts, the Lord said he was going to pour out his Spirit on the young and the old, on his men and his maidservants. Dreams and visions will come forth. The Lord had promised these things. So if you're 9 or you're 90, it doesn't matter. The Holy Spirit is moving in this place right now, wants to reveal, wants to bring forth his kingdom through you right now. Thank you, Jesus. We trust in you.
crossed over on dry land. He said, I am the way. Where it seems impossible, he makes the way. And you shall cross over on dry land. And it's the mystery of the Spirit, where there is water and there is dry land.
Mm-hmm.
The water of his Spirit, the river, flows all around, but we walk across on dry land, sure-footed, trusting in him. He will make the way.
We're going to worship the Lord with one more song. But don't necessarily look at these words on the screen. I believe the Lord wants to reveal something more. This is just the beginning. We're just seeing the tip of it. As we worship him, enter in, church. Just enter in. If you young ones don't understand, the Lord is here, and he wants to speak to your heart. Just let him speak. Hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy. Let the Lord minister.
Praise God. I just want to say everything that was spoken here, and Jane, I believe what you were saying is that that was unbelief that was going. Because it bears witness to everything everybody else was saying. And the Holy Spirit, you know, bears witness with our spirit. So there's always a connection. I felt that was what the Lord spoke to me as soon as you said it. Mike was talking about being in the river and that unbelief would go. Suzanne says that, you know, we're to cross over on dry land. Well, the reason they were fearful is because of their unbelief.
Yeah.
And then Tammy says he makes all things new. And this is exactly what I'm going to be preaching about this morning. I mean, it's just as if, you know, the Lord just gives you an outline. And then says, because all the time, you know, you question, is this for sure where the way you want to go, you know? And then he removes all doubt by just validating everything that he's speaking. So I'm so grateful to God. You know, Sheila was talking about the boldness to step out. And we all need that. And it's just a question of unbelief.
Yeah.
That's where fear always, you know, finds its roots. We don't believe that he's going to heal. You know, we don't really believe that he's going to give us that financial breakthrough. We don't believe that he'll back us up when we go to the window of that car. Somebody will freak out and run over us, or God only knows what else. I've had some weird things happen to me. I've had beer thrown in my face. And when we used to go out door to door when I was younger and more able to defend myself. But never did anyone, no one was ever hurt. I mean, threats and things like that. But I never saw anyone ever really receive a wound or anything from anybody. And I just believe that's the way it is. I just think God has always got our back. And if we're being obedient to him, and you know, I think a lot of times he gives us challenges.
Amen.
Just like Sheila, you know, you're fighting with yourself. We all do that. I mean, when God tells us to speak to somebody or share something, and we're questioning, is that really you, Lord, or is this just me? Or if it's you, how are they going to respond? And I think a lot of times God wants to take us to another level. But to get us to the next level, we got to believe him on this level. And so sometimes he puts out these little tests, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Will you? And yeah, we struggle. But when you do, you know there's a victory. I'll bet you felt that, Sheila. There's a victory even regardless of their response. Because the victory is in being obedient to what the Spirit is having us do. It isn't so much what the results are.
Right.
The victory comes the moment you step out in faith. That pleases God. That honors God. And that's what he's really looking for more than anything else. We may never know, in this case, what the outcome of this is for that woman. But a lot of times, unbelievers especially, they're as shocked and stunned by somebody coming and saying something to them that is about what they've been questioning and wondering and reaching out to. They don't know what to say either. They're kind of freaked.
Right.
You know, they're used to the 900 numbers and the psychic hotline or whatever, you know. And so when somebody just out of the clear blue comes and shares something like that with them, it just kind of stuns them. So, you know, I believe God's, the beauty of it is, even with just a handful of people, God is totally, purposefully trying to express himself.
Amen.
He doesn't need thousands. We like thousands. But he always chooses the small things. And so sometimes you can have the greatest impact in just a little group. I mean, how many have been in group meetings or just in a home Bible study or just you and your wife or you and a couple of friends? And, man, I mean, God just can move so unbelievably. Part of the reason is because of the lack of unbelief.
Right.
You're expecting God to do something, and he will.
Amen.
Amen. Let's give him a hand clap this morning. Praise the Lord. Praise God. Amen. God bless you. The young people can be dismissed, and thank you, worship team, as always. Appreciate it. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. So if you were listening to the words of knowledge and prophecy that God was releasing through different ones this morning, you'll recognize this as we move along into this message. But I'm just going to use one verse of Scripture to begin with, and that's Luke chapter 24, verse 25. Luke 24, verse 25. And happy Father's Day to all of you. And I hope you all get a chance to spend some time with your family. Fathers, if you're fortunate to still have them. If not, why, with the rest of your family. Praise the Lord. Then he said unto them, O fools, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Praise the Lord. Even today, you know, we have a tendency toward the same two challenges. Number one, not understanding his word. And number two, being slow to believe it.
Yeah.
So there's believers today even who don't understand what God's word really says. Mark was talking about, when he was in a more quote-unquote religious kind of environment. And all of us have to admit that we've come from varying degrees of understanding of the word and thinking we understand it at one point only to find out that we didn't understand it so much after all. There was more to it, greater depth, greater meaning that God was trying to get across. But even when we do understand the word, or at least what it says, a lot of times we're still slow of heart to believe it. So people read the word, and instead of seeing Jesus, they see rules. They see laws. They see demands. So look at Romans chapter 10 and verse 2. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. A great celebration of Joni's life yesterday. And if you wanted to see a manifestation of God's presence, it came with every, there were probably, I don't know, 40 people there, maybe 50, I don't know, I don't count them, but out of those 40 or so people, 85%, I would say, shared some anecdotal kind of words of their relationship with Joni, what she meant to them, how she had moved, touched their lives, affected them in different ways. It was so beautiful. And it was just, that's what we're talking about when we say manifesting Christ in our revealing Jesus or expressing Christ. Funerals are never fun, but man, it's such a blessing when you see positive things, not just people morose and depressed and bummed out. There's always that. I mean, there's always going to be grieving. That's part of the process. But to see a celebration at the same time, it's just amazing. And that only happens with Christians. I've done funerals in all kinds of circumstances. I used to do them just for the funeral homes when they couldn't get anybody else to do it. You know, if you'd done them for them before, they'll call you and ask if you would do this when they don't have a church. They're not necessarily. You know, I mean, it's unbelievable because you don't know what anybody believes. Most of them are not believers. That's why they don't have a church. It's just, it's the saddest, most depressing thing you can imagine. And you try to put as positive a spin on it as possible without lying to people, but it's still depressing. It's still, you know, just anger and frustration. And but when a Christian dies, it's still sad because we miss them. But it's like a victory at the same time. There's a sense of positive things undergirding all of this that's happening. And that's the beauty of the Lord. We do not die in Him. I'm off on a whole different thing. But that, I was just really happy for Robert, for the family, most importantly for Joni, in the way that Jesus was presented by everybody that was in that place. So it was a good thing. Praise the Lord. But back to what we're talking about. Romans 10:2. For I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. Praise the Lord. What knowledge? Verses 3 and 4 following. Like my computer. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. That's the knowledge that they were lacking. They had a zeal, but they lack knowledge. That knowledge. Amen. If you read the Bible and you don't see Jesus, you become a zealot for the law. If you're not seeing Jesus, you have to, only one other avenue you can take, and that is rules, laws, demands, anger, all those things. Amen? Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 8. Just bear with me, because we're gonna be going along here in a little bit, but we need to kind of get an idea of where we're coming from before we know where we're going. Hallelujah. And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest. Now, anybody that knows anything about Saul or Paul's history knows he was zealous for the law. He was killing, he was persecuting, and so forth. And desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, meaning Christians, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined around about him a light from heaven, and he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, Arise, and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do. Men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him to Damascus. Praise the Lord. Until Paul saw Jesus, all he wanted to do was persecute, condemn, judge. Amen? After Jesus, he ends up being the writer of two-thirds of the New Testament and all of the depth of the message of grace, which is the revelation of Christ. So, have any of you, y'all watch the History Channel? That's my favorite channel. I watch it all the time. It's crazy. Some of it's crazy, but some of it's good. I mean, there's aliens from everywhere, and they are everywhere. It must be true. It's on the History Channel, right? Hallelujah. It's amazing, but there are some good things on there, too. I love the Fast and Loud, you know, the building the hot rods, cars, motorcycles. That's a cool show. They're idiots, but the show itself is pretty good. But there's another one that I really enjoy, and that's called American Restoration. And it's really cool. They get these old junk things and restore them. You know, Rick's Restoration is actually, it's in Las Vegas. So they take junk and they restore it, And then the value of it is like thousands of times more than what it was even when it was new.
Right.
And so it's better than going out and buying a new thing, because you could buy a new one, but it isn't like having the classic, you know, that's restored. The value is just so much greater. And the difference between renewed and brand new is the gospel key to finding Jesus in the Old Testament and throughout the Scriptures. And that's what I really want to talk about. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 31, 31 through 34. See, I'm convinced of this, and I try to convince my wife of it. God will speak to you through anything.
Right.
American Restoration, fast and loud.
Right.
Praise the Lord. But he will. Because Christians, we're open to the voice of the Lord, even though the person speaking isn't trying to tell you anything. Anyway, they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. Let's go back to verse 31, if you will. This is 31, and read it, and we'll read all the way down through. Behold, the day cometh, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Now look at this. A day's coming that I'm going to make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I'll put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Now, we think of Jeremiah's promise of this new covenant, and we look at it, and we think that it means that all the previous covenants had been scrapped, and that God was starting something completely new. But God was promising something completely new. He was going to take the old promises and present them in a new and a more valuable way. That's what Jesus is doing in Luke chapter 22 and verse 20. If we can go there. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. New Testament, literally, is the new covenant, right? So Jesus was deliberately and consciously speaking God's promise of a new covenant. Right here, amen? And in Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34, which we just read, that's the one he's talking about. Right? I mean, He's speaking of that prophecy that Jeremiah gave in what we call chapter 31. The Greek translation here of the Old Testament, I'm talking about in Jeremiah, the Greek translation from the Septuagint, which was the Greek translation of the Old Testament, the actual Greek word there for new is kainos, and the word for renewed, K-A-I-N-O-S, is renewed. That's the word that Jeremiah uses. That's the same word that Jesus used. The word is renewed instead of neos, which means new or brand new. And so Luke 22:20, Jesus says it's renewed, a renewed covenant. The very same word that the Septuagint translates the original Hebrew in Jeremiah 31. Renewed covenant. We call it a new covenant, but that's not the word that they use. They didn't use neos. They used kainos. Okay? Same word that's used in Hebrews 8:13, where they're quoting, again, from Jeremiah. In that he saith, a new covenant He hath made the first old, now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. That word right there, a new covenant, it's a renewed covenant. That's the literal translation of Hebrews 13, where they're quoting from Jeremiah. He's using the very same word, okay? In other words, here's what I'm trying to say. Jesus wasn't saying that the old covenant promises should be junked. He was going to start over with a brand new slate, right? That's the way we look at it. What he was actually saying was the old covenant promises are going to be presented in a new and a better, more valuable form. And he was going to do it all himself without any contribution from us. So a divine covenant, just to clarify here, is a relationship that's initiated by a superior. And it's imposed by the superior. And it has a life or death consequence. The covenants, if you look at them closely, the covenants from the time that Adam and Eve fell, there's an Adam and Eve covenant, there's a Noah covenant, there's an Abrahamic covenant, there's a Moses covenant, there's a Davidic covenant. They were all administrations or revelations of the one divine covenant of grace. Now, I can prove how when you don't see Jesus, you end up with law. You end up with rules. You end up with condemnation and guilt. And it's not because God intended that. That just happens to be the way we read it if we're not looking for Jesus. That's what Jesus told the Jews. You search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. But they are they which speak of me. Now, they didn't have a New Testament then, so he had to be talking about the Old Testament. And he said, but you won't come to me because you don't recognize me. You're still looking for rules and laws and more zealous kind of ways of enforcing. So the promises of the covenant of grace are represented in the form of these different covenants. That's what God's trying to show us. So when Jeremiah prophesied a new covenant, he wasn't prophesying a new covenant with new parties or new terms and new promises. He was prophesying a new administration of the one covenant of grace. I've said it before, but I'll say it again just for the sake of clarifying. If God is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and Jesus Christ is the exact representation of God, then there cannot be a dichotomy here or a confusion or separation between the old covenant and the new covenant. It's just an understanding of how it's administered. And obviously, it didn't work real well under the old covenant because the people just kept trying to do more and more and more when it wasn't about what they could do in the first place. It was to bring them to a place where they would trust God. So God didn't change. Therefore, God's plan hasn't changed. Praise the Lord. So the contrast that we're talking about isn't with the old covenant of works, but the contrast is with the older administration of the one covenant of grace. Praise the Lord. So you might ask, why didn't God just reveal his covenant of grace all at once? Why didn't he just do it in the beginning? Remember now, God's working with fallen man. Foolish sinners. Amen? And he's trying to bring them into a relationship with him, a holy God. The light of that revelation. You know, I don't know about anybody else here, but my experience with God has been one of revelation. You know, and you can call it whatever you want to, but it's true for you too. You might have started here with a certain understanding. Now, if God had told me the day I was on my face in that living room in Houston, Texas, crying out to God in all of my mess, what I know today, it would have been a waste of time. I didn't really want to understand all that. I just wanted help. I just wanted something other than what I had. And God, in his foreknowledge, knows if it's like walking into, you go into a dark room, and stay in there for 10, 15 minutes, and then walk into a bright room, you don't see anything. And that's what revelation is. It's light, as was spoken of here already this morning. So if God, he just doesn't, like with, for example, Paul is a perfect example. Paul has this image of what the Bible's all about. Jesus shows up and said, hey, this is what it's all about. Bang, he can't see anything. He's blind. Too much revelation. So God has to do it incrementally, usually, and it's all based on the revelation you receive, because there's no bad revelation. I mean, what I believed, 30 years ago, it wasn't all wrong. My understanding of some of it wasn't quite right. But there was revelation there. And some of that revelation is, astounding even back then. But what the premise is, if you receive that, then God's able to give more revelation. Right? I mean, if you can't believe that there's a God, then you're not going to go to him. That's number one. He starts out with revelation. You first have to believe that there is a God. If you believe that there is a God, then it's possible for you to believe that he's a God who wants to bless you. First, believe that there's a God and that he is a rewarder of them who seek him. Everything in the scriptures is set up that way. So you can't just walk in, at 20, first time in a church, and think that you're going to know everything that you'll know at 60, 40 years later. It doesn't work that way. You couldn't handle the truth, praise the Lord. A movie I saw once, praise the Lord. But that's the bottom line here. So that's why God doesn't just dump it all on us at once, because it would overwhelm us. So he revealed his covenant of grace, but he did it bit by bit. In phases, right? It starts with simple truths and then followed by more complex truths. Right? I mean, you don't get multiplication without addition and subtraction. I mean, you can't go to, quantum physics without some understanding of time and space and, what I'm saying? So it has to start with basics and then God builds from there. And it's the same way for us as it was for them. So through the Old Testament covenants, gradually God is revealing or revealed or pictured and advanced the covenant of grace so that in the fullness of time, it could be dropped. So quickly, I want you to look at the Old Testament covenants. The covenant with Adam, which is sometimes referred to as the covenant of the defeated serpent. The covenant of Noah, or covenant with Noah, which was the covenant of the rainbow. The covenant with Abraham, which is the covenant of the knife, circumcision. Covenant with Moses, which was the covenant of the lamb and the law. And then the covenant with David, which was the covenant of an everlasting king. And then you have the promise and the fulfillment of the new covenant. Okay? So they all take place, get this, they all take place in the context of sin. Every one of them. Emphasizing that God's mercy, not human merit, is the foundation of his covenant dealings with us. These are all revelations of grace. It's Old Testament. God still had the same plan then that he has now. God was as merciful and as loving and as long-suffering and as there as he is now. He couldn't have been different or he'd be different people. Right. So they all take place in this context of sin. The covenant with Adam, this defeated serpent covenant, it came, think about this, immediately after the first sin. Right? God promises, immediately after they sin, God promises, or he covenants to reverse the effects of the first sin and restore perfect order. Praise the Lord. The covenant of the rainbow with Noah. It happens immediately after there's judgment, you know, for all the wickedness and all the sin that's in the world. Immediately after the flood. And just before, if you read the story, before Noah's further degrading sins. You can read that for yourself. It wasn't just that he got drunk. Amen. But, nevertheless, God makes this covenant in the midst of all this stuff. In the midst of all of that, God says, my grace and my mercy, because of it, I'm going to promise I'll never drown the world again. He promised that he wouldn't deal with human life here on earth according to their sin. That's the promise. The covenant of the knife with Abraham. He promised Abram a miracle son, right? Amen? God announces it to Abraham. And even when God knew that Abraham was going to soon turn his back on God, on the promise, and seek a son by sinful means, he still gave him the covenant. The covenant of the Lamb and the law. So this covenant is announced to Moses shortly, get this, after Israel had sinned in connection with both the manna and the water. They cursed the manna. Ah, we're sick of this light stuff. They complained about not having water after God had already provided for them. Got Moses so aggravated that he beats the rock instead of speaking to the rock. And yet God makes a covenant with him anyhow. Praise the Lord. And if you look at it historically, it's just before Israel sins with the golden calf. Praise God. Then there's the covenant of the everlasting king. A covenant that's announced with God's full knowledge that David is going to soon commit adultery and then murder. But it doesn't stop him from making the covenant. Then the new covenant, which is Jeremiah 31 through 34, the prediction of a new covenant for Israel, when? Just before they were exiled to Babylon because of their sin, especially the sin of covenant breaking. I mean, this is insane. Jesus announced the fulfillment of the new covenant on the eve of his exile or his death. For what? For the sins of his own spiritual Israel. Praise God. So, obviously then, the essential truth revealed by the Old Testament covenant promises is that God is gracious. God covenants with men and women, not according to their merits, but according to his mercy. God met every broken promise. Every human failure with a new promise of grace. Praise the Lord. The new covenant is the final presentation of the covenant of grace. And it's here in this present world. And it'll only yield to the eternal experience of the covenant relationship in the new heaven and the new earth. Because covenant is all about relationship. That's what God's been after through all of this. And the only way it can happen is by grace. He didn't He started out in a relationship with Adam and Eve. The whole purpose of the Bible is to restore that relationship.
Exactly.
It starts out with a covenant of grace. Immediately after they sin. Praise God. Let's close with this. Revelation chapter 21. You see, God has not changed. God loved us before the foundation of the world. I talked about it last week. The truth is, when we were born again, in the mind of God, you see, He isn't just, you know, covering up our sins. Our sins don't exist. And we as sinners don't exist. That's how, because He sees everything all at once, there is no past, present, and future with God. He looks down. He sees me perfect, righteous, holy, from forever. He isn't trying to not think about my past. I don't have a past in God. I don't have a future in God. I have a now in God. It's always now, and I'm always righteous. I'm always holy. Because that's how He says things like, we were in Christ before the foundation of the world. Meaning before we existed, God had already dealt with our sin with His foreknowledge that we would come to Him so that He never sees us as anything but righteous and pure and holy. We see it as, oh, I hope He's not thinking about that thing I did yesterday. He doesn't see anything except you perfect, righteous, and holy.
Amen.
And that's the way He's always wanted it. And we have to come to a place where we begin to see ourselves this way and see God in that light so that we can always have an expectation of good.
Amen.
So that we know that God, He sees me as He sees Jesus. So He, if He would not withhold Him, why would He withhold anything, He says, from us? See, He won't. But just like with the believers in the early church and prior to that they're referring to there in Luke chapter 24, they have a zeal for God, but a knowledge that is limited. And so Jesus, speaking to them in Luke chapter 24, says, oh, foolish and slow of heart to believe that God wants you to be blessed, that God wants you to have everything that He purchased for you. Amen? This is Revelation 21. 3-5. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them, and they shall be His people, and God Himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And He that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things renewed. And He said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. Praise the Lord. You can say, you can look at it any way you want to, but from Rick's perspective, we are renewed. We're more valuable than the new. We have a value that is far greater than any new thing. It's a renewed thing. It's a renewed thing from God. It's called being born again. Amen? And your value increases exponentially because now you are an heir and a joint heir with Christ. So no matter what you could have done in that new state, you could have never gotten to that place of value. God sets the value. And He says, priceless. Amen?
Amen?
Now, if He's willing to pay that price, you think he's going to just leave you out in a ditch somewhere? He's going to protect that investment. Guys got classic cars, man. They spend as much on and warehousing and climate control and humidity and all these things as they do for the actual vehicle. Believe me, God doesn't look at you as just an old toy. You're a classic. Praise God. A classic investment. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Not a new covenant, church. A renewed covenant. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God loved you then. He loves you now. He loves you forever. We ought to thank God. We ought to have an expectation. Amen? That when we come to God, we can believe God. So that we can get what it is he wants us to have. But you've got to believe that he's a lover of you. As Sheila said, he's just not mad at you. He's madly in love with you. I know that sounds awkward. You know, it's hard for us to say that sometimes. But, you know, he has this passion. And it exceeds everything else. His pursuit of us. You got to believe that. He would not have given his life in the person of Jesus Christ. I was trying to think. There was a Catholic priest by the name of Manning. Had a messed up life. Alcoholic. And I've read several of his books. But he has one about this passion of pursuing God. And how through his failures, he left the priesthood, eventually got married, he was an alcoholic, so on and so forth. But then he came back, not to the priesthood, but back into ministry. And his whole ministry was about God's grace. How in all of his failures, God was always there. God was always reaching for him. God was always loving him. And, you know, it's profound because we have such a hard time seeing God that way. We always see him through our failures and our weaknesses. But look at this. I mean, that's what's important about this, not just as a history lesson or a theological, you know, basis to speak from, but it's the truth. Every time they sin, God comes back with another promise of grace. And he doesn't say anything to them about how you bad boy. I mean, imagine. He's going to make a covenant with David that his family will never leave the throne of Israel. His offspring. Will you imagine the honor? Jesus came from that family line. Knowing that just in a very short matter of time, this guy that he's making this promise of grace to is going to go out and commit adultery, and then to compound the sin, he's going to murder the guy's or the woman's husband that he had adultery with. Now, come on. Our image of God is distorted. And that's why we have all these covenants in there, is so that we can get a clear picture of this Jesus that's going to come. And because they always looked at the rules instead of what they were representing, he shows up and they don't have a clue who he is. Abraham, I mean, these are the father of faith. Give me a break. God makes a covenant with him that he's going to give him a miracle son, and the first thing he does out, go out and jump the bones of his wife's maid. Pardon the vernacular, but I mean, come on. That doesn't sound like somebody real faithful to me. Sounds like somebody that's just working the system. Well, take my maid. Oh my God, I couldn't do that. When? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Noah. The whole earth has been destroyed because of sin. God knows Noah's going to get drunk and do some sinful stuff himself. But he instead declares him to be righteous by faith. And gives him a promise. I'm never going to deal with man based on their failures anymore. Adam and Eve still have apple in their teeth, and God's telling them, I'm going to stomp on the serpent that tricked you.
Yeah.
This is our God.
Yes, it is. Yes.
And he's revealed in the person of Jesus Christ, through whom grace and truth came.
Yes.
That has to be, you know, I know, just like Paul said, if you preach it the way it should be preached, radical grace, then there'll be attacks. But I'm convinced that only through grace can we ever, ever come to a place where we can really represent Jesus. You know, God knows all of us have plenty of flaws. And I'd say even Joni. And yet, what people saw was this Christ-likeness. That's not putting Joni down. I love Joni. Joni, you know, she was good to me. But you understand what I'm saying? What was said up here this morning? They'll see Christ. And they'll see him clearly when we extend grace to them. When we're not saying, well, when you get that act together and when you get this cleaned up and you get that fixed up, then, you know, come on, we'll pray with you. Jesus, knowing their failures that would come, dealt with them as though they were perfect right then. Is that dangerous? Of course it is. It's not dangerous for God. It's only dangerous for us that keep score. They did me wrong. Well, come on. Those that he came to save did him wrong. But he did it anyhow. Praise the Lord. Think about it. God is never mad at you. Never. He loves you like nobody can love you. And all he asks of us is to believe. Believe that whatsoever you ask of him, believing, you'll receive it.
Yeah.
It's our belief that honors him. It's our faith, our confidence in his goodness and his grace that honors God and will honor God and bring glory to God throughout eternity.
Amen.
Praise God. That's the only part we play. I believe. That's it. It's settled. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So I just challenge you this week, when you leave here today, you believe God for big things. Big things. The bigger you can believe him for, the happier it makes God. Amen. Believe him for breakthroughs where you haven't had breakthroughs, because that's what he wants for you. He wants you to be beside yourself. He wants to be you to be like the little kid on Christmas morning that gets up and he can't tear open the packages quick enough. And he's so distracted from one good thing to the next that he forgets what he's got here and runs to the next one. And it takes him weeks to even figure out what he actually got for Christmas. God wants to pour out on you blessings that you can't even contain. He wants to overwhelm you with his grace, with his love, with his giftings. All we got to do is believe. Amen. And watch it manifest. God bless you. Have a great week. Have a great Father's Day. Amen. And women. Praise the Lord. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.